Very excited. Seventh night. Beautiful weather. Absolute perfection. We finally got the fires. We got the fire system like figured out. Huh. We're like good. So last year it was kind of funny. Grace Brethren, who's here with us tonight, they were with us last year and it downpoured for the whole night. And when I look back at last year, it was actually my favorite night. I really enjoyed it. I stood right there and worshiped as down in the downpour, and I went home soaking wet. And that night, I was just like so full when I went home, in a spiritual perspective. So I'm very excited to have these guys here again, and they're going to lead us in worship tonight. We've been going through, this year has been more of a journey. Last week was very informational in the preaching. This year has been a real spiritual journey for me. And so that's where we're going to be at in the Word tonight. But I just want to have you chew on this scripture before we begin, or maybe even while we're worshiping. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. It says, "From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. And behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation." There's a lot in that scripture for us to chew on. That's where we're going to end up tonight. And what I'm really hoping tonight turns into is the word is going to be kind of my takeaways from the last 6 days. And so I would love to hear what God is doing in your life over the last 6 days, what he's been speaking to you. And if there is something that we can that you can share, I think this would be an awesome night to do that. So we'll have a microphone available, and just if God lays it on your heart, please come up and share. Or if he lays it on your heart to declare something over the community or over the city or over our nation, this would be an awesome night for that. So with that, let's pray, and we're going to get into worship tonight. Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for our brothers and sisters joining us from West Kittanning, and God, I just pray that you would fill them tonight too. Let them be able to lead undistracted and full of your Spirit. Of us, as we're here worshiping you tonight, that you would tabernacle with us, that you would meet with us intimately, and that we would know you better when we leave this place than when we came. We pray your protection over this property, Lord, that you would seal it, that you would make this a place that is only for you, that the enemy would have no place here. And Lord, we pray for your direction tonight. God, that you would just take over this service, that you would be with us in all that we do, and that it would be your name that would be glorified in this place. Lord, we pray for your presence, your manifest presence in this place, that it would be unmistakable, that the joy would be unspeakable, that we would be lit on fire and worship for you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. It's all yours.
Thank you. God is not from God.
Check, check. There you go. I just want us to proclaim something into the atmosphere here. If we could just play that that chorus or whatever. City and all across the county, and one from across the state and other counties, and so it's just very exciting what I believe that God is doing in Kittanning. And it's not just Living Water Church, it's just it's the Church of Kittanning coming together in unity, and you guys joining in, and it's just it's awesome to me. He's awesome. Amen? Alright. Sorry, just had to get that out of my system. So, sorry, you can sit down again if you want to. Unless you want to stand for the sermon, that's fine too. You won't offend me either way. So, there have been some common themes throughout the week that God has continued to bring up, and even leading up to Tabernacles, just over and over again. And so I have four of those that I just want to touch on tonight. I had kind of a different plan at the beginning of the week. You might remember the very first night I said God changed the whole message and all the scriptures were different. And so it ended up being that many of the scriptures that I was going to use were the things that he confirmed throughout the week that we're here talking about here tonight. So it's pretty cool, this God that we have. He's always working. He's always like putting things together in the way that he intends to, not the way that we intend, which is good, right? Because our plan is not always very good. His plan is always perfect. And so when we lean into his plan, we can be guaranteed great success. So the first one, God says over and over and over again, and I didn't send anyone what we were talking about throughout the week. I just gave everyone a loose idea of what I was looking for the week, and then all the preachers just did whatever they felt God wanted them to do. And I think five out of six of them used the scripture at some point in their message. Am I cutting in on that? Is it me?
Yeah.
Okay. Looks good. I'll put it in the other pocket. 5 of 6 use a scripture that reference God saying, they will be my people and I will be their God. And so I looked it up last night trying to figure out how many of those scriptures are there actually in the Old Testament and the New. Because the New Testament uses a lot of those same references that are in Ezekiel and Jeremiah and Isaiah. And it's just all over the place. There's over 40 references in the Bible that uses basically those exact terms. Of God being their God and Israel being his people. Or in our case, the church being his people. And so it's a pretty big theme throughout the Bible. God has brought up to me over and over and over again over these past several weeks. And I just can't seem to escape it. And what was really interesting is I led worship this morning, which, you know, I do sometimes at the church. And I ended up picking all these songs that I had written over time. Songs like Joy Rise Up, songs like Crown You. And I didn't really anticipate what God was going to do this morning. But it was like all of the songs were even lining up with that theme. And I realized that God's been working this in me for 6 or 7 years. Like the last verse in Crown You is, I am your child, and you are my God. So I crown you. And it's just been like this journey for me that God is, it seems like, I don't know, maybe it's what Israel felt like. I had to go all the way around the mountain to get back to where I started. Anyone else ever feel that way? But it doesn't feel like I'm in the wilderness. It just feels like he's causing me to circle back, and I'm seeing the good things that he's done before in my life, and here I am today, and I'm just, the command and the call is still the same. Like, even if you've been walking with Jesus for 40 or 50 years, he's still saying, my child. He's not looking at you any differently. Even though you've changed a lot, even though a lot's changed probably between that time and now, you're still just his child. If you never graduate from that, we're just sons and daughters of the King. And that's a good thing, right? That we can never move on from that. Like, we could bask for all of eternity just in that truth. And that would be enough, would it not? Are you guys alive tonight?
Yeah.
You're here? Okay. So I'm going to read one of these. Chuck King actually preached this exact scripture. I referenced it the first night as well. Ezekiel 36 says this, I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. And so I don't know if God's done that work in you tonight. I hope that he has. I know that he's done it in me. Has he pulled out that heart of stone out of your chest and given you a heart that can feel again? So many times in this world, I think we kind of lose God's heart for people. It's very easy, especially over the last couple of years, with the political atmosphere and all of the things surrounding the government shutdowns and all that different kind of stuff. It's very easy for our hearts to become calloused and for us to no longer have any kind of empathy or care for other people. It's become very easy for our media to just, both sides, to basically proclaim the other side as complete demons and not even worthy of acknowledgement. And we have gotten to that point where now if the divide is so deep in our country that we almost don't even want to have conversation with the other side anymore. And that's never the way God would intend it to be. Like, God loves Republicans just the same as he loves Democrats. I know that's hard to believe, right? But we're all part of God's creation. And even though some of us have gone down the wrong road, I'm not going to say which one because I don't want to get into all that tonight. But seriously, even though we're very different, we are all made in God's image. We are all his children. Now, it's really interesting in Ezekiel here that it's the ones whose God has changed their hearts that he calls his people. And that he says that he is their God. This is a very personal thing too, that after you become saved, we can see and experience and acknowledge God in a different way than we could before. When we have just a head knowledge of God, it's different than when we have a heart knowledge of Him. And so when He does that work of heart surgery on you, we become different people. And now we are in the kingdom, and we are His children. But our great desire is that even the people that don't know Him, we should want them to experience that too. Even if we disagree with them, even if they are disagreeable towards us, we should still pray for them and desire their transformation, that they could have this same experience with the Lord that we've had. Amen? And so that's been the first theme. They will be my people, and I will be their God. And that kind of comes back into like a... I love those things. Except right now. I don't really like them right now. All right. The second one is this issue of trust. That's been a theme kind of throughout the week, over the last few nights especially. Jamie hit on that really hard on Thursday, and it just resonated in my spirit that we need to be a people that trust God. And if you'll notice, these 4 points, they all kind of flow into each other, and I think that's by God's design. So in order to be His people and for Him to be our God, we have to trust Him, right? Nobody wants a father that they don't trust. Some of you may have had earthly fathers that you didn't trust, that did you wrong, that did all kinds of bad things. Some of you may have unspeakable stories about your father, but our Father in Heaven is not that way. A lot of times we carry things from our relationship with our earthly parents into our relationship with God, but we can't do that. This is a whole different thing. God is holy, and we sung about it tonight. He is completely set apart. He is completely different from your earthly father. He is way better than you could possibly ask or imagine. He is God. He is the ultimate loving Father. And so we need to have trust, and along with that trust comes with a restoration of innocence, was the way Jamie put it. And I really love that. Because, I don't know, just by a show of hands, how many of you have been burned by someone in the world? Anyone? Okay. So mostly all of you, right? We've all been hurt by people, right? And it causes us to be callous. It causes us to not want to trust again. And we lose kind of the childlike innocence that we were born with. Like the reason that children are, they're so like free to dance around and be foolish. And we would think that, when I say foolish, I don't mean it in a bad way, okay? I mean they're actually free. They're not afraid of the judgment of other people. But something happens in our teenage years, and all of a sudden, like, the freedom that we had as children, this, like, shame and this guilt and this, like, unwillingness to look foolish to anyone else creeps in, and all of a sudden we don't want to dance anymore, and we don't want to sing anymore, and we don't want to just be free anymore. We lose our, I hate to say it, but we lose our fun. The kingdom of God is very fun, my friends. It's very fun. Your relationship with Jesus should be like the greatest party of your life until you die. And then the greater party starts. Like, it's just joy. Unspeakable is what we should be experiencing, what we should be walking around with when we're with Him. Jesus actually spoke to this kind of innocence. He referenced children, and so I'm going to just read those two scriptures. Matthew chapter 18, verse 1, it says, "At that time, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, 'Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?'" And so the disciples were always about this, right? They were always jockeying for position. They were always wanted to be like the best apostle. And even, if you remember James and John, their mother came in and vouched for them and said, "Hey, put these two on your right and left in the kingdom." But Jesus had other plans. Jesus calls over to Him a child. He brings the child into the midst of them, and He says, "Truly, I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." And so children, at a young age, they don't really have a pride about them. They don't really have a shame about them. Those things are like, I mean, there is such a thing as original sin. But like my children, when they were really little, they didn't seem to really care who got the credit for anything. They were just happy to be around, happy to be alive. They didn't have any shame about them. They had no problem making a fool of themselves. And we think that it's really cute, right? When they're kids. And then at some point, we get to be like, oh gosh, the name is escaping me. The woman in Samuel who made fun of David for dancing. Someone help me. Yeah, so she is it Mike? Is it McCall? I don't know how to pronounce it. But anyways, yes, that's her. And so David's dancing around, and he's worshiping the Lord with everything that he has. And we've had some dancing around this place throughout the week. And I hope you haven't been like looking at each other and thinking, wow, that person looks like an idiot. Because we should look at the people that can worship in true freedom, and we should be saying to ourselves, I want that. I want to have that childlike freedom again. I want to be able to worship God without fear that everyone else is looking at me. I want to just be me and Him, so that when I pour out myself and worship to Him, that I'm not thinking about anyone else. I'm just beholding the face of the glory of the Father. That should be our goal, friends. And so we have to humble ourselves, put away our pride, and worship Him like little children. That's how we get into the kingdom of heaven, Jesus says. Our prideful hearts won't get us there. We have to, number one, trust that God is good, and go in with a humility and an innocence that is like that of a child. Is that your relationship with God? Mark 10 has a similar scripture. They were bringing children to Jesus that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked the people. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a small child shall not enter it." And he took them in his arms, and he blessed them, laying his hands on them. And so, number one, we get the knowledge that Jesus loves children. And so we see all these kids that have come here throughout the week that have just hung out with us and ate untold amounts of s'mores and done all kinds of like games and had this great time in the parking lot and then on the trail and all these kinds of things. We have to have an intimate knowledge that Jesus loves the children. And so I think a lot of times our community has had this idea that children are a nuisance, that children are the ones that are wrecking everything and all those kinds of things. That may be true to a certain extent, but Jesus loves them. And these kids, when you direct them in the right direction, when you give them something positive to do, they grab onto it. And it's a beautiful thing. We're witnessing it happen with our youth night here. This thing that started with like 10 kids, we've had up to like 35 on some nights. And these kids come. And they worship. And sometimes they don't want to stop worshiping. They're in the Word. They're learning about Him. The little ones especially, they still have that childlike innocence. The teenagers, not so much. They get grown up and then they have the shame on them already. The pride starts to creep in. But we need to cultivate an atmosphere in our own Christian life that's childlike faith. Where we come to the Father without pride, without preconception, wholly and completely trusting that He is good. And so Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven is what they will inherit, the people that come to Him with humility like little children. And so what is the kingdom of heaven? That's a question we have to answer. What is the kingdom of heaven? Anyone have an answer for me? Is it just heaven? Is it just like off in the future somewhere after we die? Is that the kingdom of heaven? Place of everlasting life. I like that answer. The presence of God. I like that answer too. Anyone else? Say it again. Spirit living in us. Ooh, I really like that answer. So I have a working definition here. I don't know how accurate this is, but I'm kind of reading through all these scriptures because Jesus told us a lot, especially in the book of Matthew. He said, the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like. And so we can get a pretty good idea of what the kingdom of heaven is like. So here's the working definition. It's God's original plan for this earth being restored through the lordship of Jesus Christ. Being restored through those sons and daughters who believe in him. The kingdom of heaven is how those children are to behave on this earth. And the kingdom of heaven is the inheritance that we have as sons and daughters of God. There's a lot of different things happening here, but I think if I would simplify all that into just one sentence, I would say the kingdom of heaven is heaven invading the fallen earth. Jesus came to restore the earth back to its original condition. You understand that? Like, he came to seek and save the lost, and then he set the church here. He's left us here to build the kingdom of heaven. Like, that's what we're doing right now. When we worship him, when we put things out into the atmosphere, when we set a good example for those around us, when we witness to people that don't know Jesus, we are active ambassadors for the kingdom of heaven on this earth. Do you realize that? Like, you, if you're saved tonight, if you know Jesus tonight, you are an active ambassador right now. God has sent you on a mission to be an ambassador to his kingdom on this earth, and the goal of your life is that the kingdom, the sphere of influence that you've been given on this earthly realm, that it would look as much as possible like the kingdom of heaven by the time you die. That's why he's put you here. You are to be an influence on this earth for his glory. That's why we're here. Matthew 6:31, this is just one example. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all those things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. And so we see a fallen world, right? There's anxiety in the world, always thinking, oh, how am I going to get this next thing? I need this, I need to make sure that we have enough for school clothes this year. Or we need to make sure that we get grocery shopping, or all those kinds of things. And we add all of this anxiety and burden onto ourselves. And that's what the worldly system does. Anyone else agree that we live in a very anxious world? Like, we live in a very stressed out society. And Jesus says, we shouldn't be living stressed out. That's not how the kingdom of heaven works. And so, if you seek the kingdom of heaven and all his righteousness, then all of those things will be added unto you. And if you just had knowledge that your heavenly Father is good, like, he knows what you need. You don't have to worry about it. It's not going to help you obtain it, just worrying about it. He already knows. Let's just trust him and seek his kingdom, and everything will work out. See, that's taking a worldly system that would heap stress and anxiety and depression on you. And Jesus says, no, the kingdom of heaven is a different way. And if you would seek that different way, then everything would be different in your life. You see that? Kingdom of heaven invading earth. And so it's not just something after you die. It's not just something that we're looking forward to someday. It can be here and now. In fact, that's what Jesus taught us. And that's the third point. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Did Jesus teach us to pray that way? I can't hear you. Yes, Jesus taught us to pray that way. Like, it's one of the first things that we learned in Christianity. Even I was raised Catholic. We learned the Our Father before I could even, like, say complete sentences of other things. I could say the Our Father. Like, that's how we learned that to say that is our prayer every night. And we actually did exactly what Jesus told us not to do. We made it into, like, empty words, this just, like, rote thing that we did every day. I didn't even know what I was saying when I was saying it. I just memorized it as a child. But now, revisiting as an adult, we can see, like, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In context of all these other scriptures that say the kingdom of heaven is like, we can have a blueprint here through the book of Matthew for all the different things that we should be praying for as believers to take heaven and bring it down to earth, right here in Kittanning, as it is in heaven. Isn't that good? I feel like I'm the only one that's excited tonight. Jesus said in Matthew 6, "When you pray, do not heap up empty praises as the Gentiles do, for they think that they'll be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him." Same theme, right? That he says just a little bit further that we read earlier. It says, "Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." And so Jesus gives us this model prayer. And I think it's really interesting to me to go through that line by line and look at it and really try to think of, like, what does that look like practically in my prayer life? Because I don't think we should just necessarily just pray the Our Father. I think we should dissect these things and figure out, okay, Jesus, what is it actually that you want me to pray for? For example, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Like, we should have a reverent fear, a reverent awe when we enter into prayer with the knowledge that our Father is holy. Our Father, he is God Almighty. Yes, he loves you. Yes, he has grace for you. Yes, he is merciful, and his mercies are new every morning. But our God is holy. To go into his presence, like, it should set us into, it should cause us to almost fall to our knees when we consider the fact that we can enter into the throne room of God, to the Lord Almighty, and he allows us to pray with him, to commune with him, like Moses did. As a man speaks to a friend, you and I have this opportunity to speak with God Almighty. That's amazing. And so, instead of just saying, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name," you don't even really have to say that. As long as you're going into his presence with a reverent awe, I think that we are modeling prayer in the way that Jesus wanted us to model it. Does that make sense? Yeah? No? Yeah? Okay, good. And so when we begin to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," those should not just be empty words either. Once again, earlier I said, God has given each one of you a sphere of influence on this earth. When we pray, we should be praying very specifically for that sphere of influence that God has placed you in. You should be looking for the things, like Jesus pointed out here in Matthew 6:33. Like, you can look for places of anxiety. And you can say, "God, this place of anxiety is not of your kingdom. Father, I pray that the peace that you offer everyone on this earth that knows you, that peace would enter into this situation, that anxiety would be gone, that we would begin in this situation to seek your kingdom first, that we would begin to trust you in everything, and that heaven would come down and change things." We should begin to pray that way. Am I crazy? That's what he's put us here for. That his kingdom would come and that his will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's why you're here, friends. Last one. This wasn't really a theme through the whole thing, but it spoke so strongly to me. This was when Jamie was here as well. He had a vision when I took him up. We had some intercessors praying in the church over the night, and I took him up there. And they began to pray over him as well. And we were just preparing for the service and seeking the Lord. And he said later in the night that when he went in there, as soon as people began to pray, he saw this like mountain of coal. And he wasn't sure what it was. It was like a black mountain. And he said that he thought it represented like industry and us trusting in industry to be kind of the savior and not trusting God. And that maybe our area had been burned by industry in the past, and that those hurts and those harms from the past we were still carrying into our lives today. And I don't know if you know much about Armstrong County history, But I think that's a pretty good, like, synopsis of where we've been over the last 50 years. Is that true? I've only been here for the last 10. But I know the stories of what happened. I know that PPG was the largest employer in the county, right? Thousands of jobs. And when they closed down, it decimated Ford City and Kittanning. And that was filled with Elger, which was like a quarter of the jobs that were there originally, I believe. I don't know the exact number. And then that closed down. And it's like all of these things have gradually moved to different places or moved overseas. And those, I really believe that the communities probably felt abandoned by these companies. Like, we worked for you. We built up these multi-billion dollar industries. And then they just go. And what happened to the families? They were completely decimated. You have the incomes go to nothing. We had the population in Kittanning 50 years ago was double what it is today. And so you have half the amount of people trying to pay for the same amount of infrastructure, so the taxes continue to rise and rise and rise. And those families that were thrown into poverty through no fault of their own, so many of them turned to drugs and turned to government help, and now we have generational poverty, generational cycles of addiction, all stemming from that one thing. You see that like I did? That's kind of the story, not just of Kittanning and not just of Ford City. That's the story of the Rust Belt across America. It's a story that's been told 1,000 times over as manufacturers have left here and gone to China or other places in Southeast Asia or other places anywhere else in the world or anywhere else in the country. And I think we really do feel betrayed by industry. We feel betrayed by our government. We feel betrayed by so many different things. Some of us then feel betrayed by our parents. Some of us feel betrayed by our friends and our family. And so I was thinking about that mountain of coal that we've maybe trusted in or looked to or looked at as a savior. Because I heard 1,000 times over, I can't even count how many times I've heard, when I was doing the Greatest City in the World videos in the beginning, people always tell me, you'll never change anything. You'll never change anything. And the only way that this place will ever change is if a place like PPG comes back, or if a place like Elger comes back. Then the economy could finally be lifted again, and we could finally get back to business as usual. It's like the community has been searching and looking for that savior for so long that they really can't see any other options. But there is another option. There's a way better option. Instead of trusting in industry, why don't we trust in the Lord? Instead of trusting in government, why don't we trust in the Lord? Instead of trusting in drugs and alcohol, let's trust in the Lord. Like, He is good. He is mighty to save. He's done it for you and for me. He changed our life, right? So if He can change one life, He can change 4,000. No problem. He is the hope of Kittanning. He is the hope of Armstrong County. He is the hope of the United States. And so that mountain that we've been looking to, that we've been trusting in, that mountain has to be torn down. It has to come down. And so I was thinking about this, and it took me right to Isaiah chapter 40. You guys that go to Living Water Church, I'm sure you know the scripture by now. It's one of my favorite revelations that I've ever received. Because in all the stories of John the Baptist was fulfilling a prophecy in Isaiah that was right here in Isaiah chapter 40. And it says, comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended. Her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. And it was told of John the Baptist that he was that voice crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. That was John. And so I can remember very specifically the time that the revelation came. I was reading through the Word, through that scripture about John the Baptist, and it was like Holy Spirit just asked me the question, and it said, and he said, how many roads did John build? And I was like, none, I guess. I've never heard of John the Baptist being a road builder. Like, he wasn't literally out preparing the way for the Lord. He wasn't, like, as Jesus walked forward and John saw a stick in the road, he went and, like, grabbed it and moved it out of the way so that Jesus had a clearer path. Like, that's not what John the Baptist did. So what does prepare the way mean? That was the next question from God. And I wasn't quite sure. And I really believe that he spoke to me that day and he said, the preparation was up here. John the Baptist was sent and his message was repent and believe. And repent literally means change your mind. Repent and believe. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent and be baptized. Were John's words. And so here we have in Isaiah chapter 40, this voice crying out in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill will be made low, the uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places will become a plain, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Now when I read that, and we're talking about this mountain that is in our way that we're trusting, this mountain that I know in my spirit needs to come down in order for people to get back to trusting God and looking to the proper source of salvation, I think about this, and I think about John the Baptist preparing the way of the Lord, and Jesus is the one who comes. And he can tear down every mountain, he can lift every valley, and he can make a highway for each one of us right back to our God. But it has to change up here. We have to get away from trusting things of the world first as Christians so that we can lead other people on this same path. John chapter 14 was the other thing that came up in this, because if John the Baptist prepares the way, then this hammers it home for me. John 14, verse 1. Jesus says, let not your hearts be troubled. That sounds like we're tying back to our original theme here. Trust. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way to where I'm going. And Thomas looks at him and says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And here we have maybe one of the most profound statements that ever exited the mouth of Jesus. Jesus says back to Thomas, I am the way and the truth and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you do know him and you have seen him. So John the Baptist comes to prepare the way for the Lord. He comes saying, repent and be baptized. Literally, change your mind and be washed clean so that you can accept Jesus. So that you can be ready for the kingdom of God that is coming here right now. And then Jesus comes and says, just in case you weren't sure what the way was that John was preparing, Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the light. No one can come to the Father except through him. You see, we can come up with the greatest plans in the world, and most of the time I think that I have them, okay? We can come up with the greatest plans in the world to turn Kittanning around, and to turn Armstrong County around, and to turn the United States around, and all of our grand plans will be for naught if we do them in our own power. It will not work. Like Andy's way is not the way. God's way is the way. Jesus is the way. He is the only hope that we ever have to change individually, and he is the only hope that we ever have to change corporately, and he is the only hope in the world. And so if we ever are going to get away from trusting in these other things and trusting in God, we have to go through Jesus. These mountains can only be torn down through Jesus. And so we as Christians, we as the Church of Kittanning, we need to be the ones crying in the wilderness, preparing the way for him. We need to be the ones willing to tell people, you have to repent and you have to be baptized. Like, these are the things that have to happen. Your old mindset isn't going to do it for you. Come along with me. Let's go on the way. Let's go with the truth. Let me introduce you to the life so that you can come to the Father the only way that you can, through Jesus. Through Jesus. We've been talking about all week these different things. We started with a new heart, Chuck King, a new mind, Pastor Mike Greiner, a new purpose, Jane Fitt was here, a new family, the Brookville House of Worship, Andy Burkett, a new community. Last night we had Karen Graham from Apollo, and tonight a new creation. Every single one of these things is only possible through Jesus Christ. He is the only way that any of those things can ever be changed. And so for us to look anywhere else other than to get in the presence of God through the blood of Jesus Christ is a fool's errand. It has to be him. It has to be Jesus. So we go back to where we started. This scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. This is what I think about when I think about that scripture now in the context of what we're talking about tonight. When you see broken things in the world, you shouldn't look at it through your flesh. You shouldn't judge it by your own emotions or by your own thoughts. We should judge it by the very kingdom of heaven and what God wants it to be. And so when we see problems in people that you know, or we see problems in this community, we shouldn't look at it through our eyes anymore. We shouldn't judge it according to the flesh. We should judge it according to the kingdom of heaven, friends. We have to begin to look at the problems around us, the things that need to be changed, and look at them through God's eyes. And guess what? Holy Spirit lives in you, so you really can see it through God's eyes. Isn't that amazing? Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. See, if I would meet myself 15 years ago, I would say, man, that kid looks like a lost cause. I don't know if there's any hope for him. But guess what? That old is gone. And behold, the new has come. There's a whole different person standing before you today than the person that was there 15 years ago. And I thank God that someone looked at me at one point and didn't see me for what I was, but they saw me for what I could be when the kingdom of heaven took over. Lord, give us your eyes. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Why did God reconcile you to him through Jesus? He did that so that you could be ministers of reconciliation, so that you could take the same thing that happened to you and you could go and be a light and be a hope to other people. See, there are people in this world, I know we're all uniquely made, we're uniquely and wonderfully made, like you are certainly special. There are things that are different about you than everybody else, but the fact is that the things that you've been through, chances are there's someone else in the world that's been through the same stuff. Or there's some people in the world that you know that are going through the same things now that you went through before you met Jesus. God reconciled you to himself so that you could go and speak reconciliation into those situations. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. See, Jesus went to be with the Father. He came and kicked this whole thing off, right? He started, he came, he brought the message of reconciliation to the people around him. He even reconciled some people to the Father. But when he left, he said he was sending a helper. He empowered the Spirit-filled believers to go through this world. And they are now, verse 20, the ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us, that is, through you. Jesus isn't here to give that message anymore. He's left it to you. And he's left it to me. And that can either be really exciting, or it can be really terrifying. Because you feel like sometimes when I think about that, I feel like the weight of the world is on my shoulders. And I think, God, how could you entrust something like that to me? And I think he looks back at us and he says, well, it's not really you that's going to do it anyway, it's me and you. You're just kind of along for the ride. You have to just lay yourself down and let me work. Like we talked about earlier today. God is to be in our life like a pillar of fire and a pillar of the cloud. And when we wake up in the morning, we look to him and we say, okay, God, what do you want to do today? That should be our life, friends. Our priority cannot be this, like, American culture. We should not wake up in the morning and base our schedule off of when the Steelers play next. Or we should not base our schedule off of when the next soccer game is, or when the next school function is, or when the next whatever the world would point to. Our first and primary goal, our first and primary mission, our first and primary job is you are ambassadors of the King of the Kingdom of God. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. That's all I got. Just a review. They will be my people and I will be their God. He wants to restore a proper relationship with his church in Kittanning, and I believe in Western Pennsylvania. God wants to restore our trust in him. God wants to restore the innocence that the enemy has stolen out of your life so that you can come to him afresh as little children. He wants us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as is in heaven, in whatever sphere of influence you have been given. No matter how large or how small, each one of us is to be praying, the kingdom of heaven come down. And lastly, we need to look at these mountains that are around us, and we need to be voices crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, repent and be baptized, and turn to the only way that can get us back to the Father. Amen? Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for this week. We thank you for these revelations. Lord, this is spiritual food to me. We cannot survive without you. We cannot make it through this life without you. And Lord, it is only by your revelation that we see the next step. And so I thank you for your revelation this week. I thank you that you've given us a mission, that you've made every single person here tonight an ambassador for you on this earth. Lord, I pray that we would take that job seriously, and I also pray, Lord, that that job would not overwhelm us, that we would cast off any kind of heavy burden the enemy would try to lay on our shoulders, and that we would take on your burden. Take on your yoke, which is easy and light. Lord, we know that we're not pulling this yoke alone, that you are there right beside us, walking step instead. That you are the one doing the work, and we are simply cooperating. We are simply along for the ride. Help us, Lord, to trust you like little children. Help us to look to you in everything we do. Help us to carry this torch of tabernacles away from this place and into our homes, into our workplaces, into our cars when we're driving, into our church functions, into everything that we do, Lord. Let us be led by your presence, and let us seek your presence. Thank you for Jesus and the blood that makes all of that possible. Thank you for his sacrifice that tore the veil so that we can be with you tonight and every night. It's in his precious name we pray. Amen. As the worship team comes back up, I just want to invite you guys, if you have a word, just please come up. If you have something that God is speaking to you tonight or any of the other nights when we've been here, just come on up and let's continue to worship him, speak good things over our city. Chapter 4,
Verse 7, this is incredible stuff. Zechariah sees this vision of the golden lampstands, and it's almost a picture of Revelation, to be honest with you. And then he said to me, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts." It's not in us, friends, that the mountain is going to come down. Verse 7, "Who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel you shall become a plain, and he shall bring forward the top stone amid shouts of grace, grace to it." I mean, how amazing is that? "Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. His hands have also completed it. Then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you. For whoever has despised the day of small things shall rejoice and shall see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel." And so we just proclaim over this city. We say, mountains, mountains that we've trusted in, come down and let a new foundation be laid in this city. A foundation based upon Jesus Christ, the only firm foundation for the hope of the world.
Thank you. Thank you.
just want to remind you guys, tomorrow is the last night. It's crazy how fast 8 days can go, but tomorrow's it. We have LifeSpring Christian Church with us tomorrow. Our bishop, Dale Adams, that's his church, and so they're coming up from Greensburg, Pennsylvania to join us tomorrow in worship, and he's bringing the word as well, and so we're very excited for that. So take these words and these songs home in your heart. Figure out what God wants you to do. We are his ambassadors, my friends. You have been given a sphere of influence. Some of you may not think so right now. Pray that God would open your eyes to it. Let him use you. This tabernacles thing is not 8 days a year. It's supposed to be all the time. This is just a biblical representation of it to get us reset in this new year. Be living for him. Just thank you, Lord, for what you've done this week so far. Pray for tomorrow. We pray for Grace Brethren Church. What a light in the community and the school that they have and the Christian education they're providing to the children of this community. And God, we just pray that you continue to bless them, that you pour out on them a fresh measure of your spirit, fresh measure of your grace and your mercy and your love and your peace. Let them go from this place in joy. Thank you again for bringing them to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
I should say too, if anyone wants a shirt,
get a shirt. Pay whatever you want to. If you can't pay, just take one with you. We're going to have a lot left over, I think, so I'd rather you just get a shirt and take one home.
Yeah.